would do, but I'd probably break it. Yeah. Is that just on the big button or? Yeah, perfect. Yeah, we can check it out. Just let me know when you're ready. We'll call it to order. Okay. All right, let's call the meeting to order. If we could, can you pull up the agenda, Christine, so we can approve it? Or do we just approve as... Okay, can we have a motion to approve the agenda? Moved by Campbell, seconded by Luke. Any discussion? All those in favor? Motion is carried. Any disclosures of interest for this meeting? None noted. We'll move forward to reports. Okay. Do I need to read the discussion? The disclosure? Okay, so the first report. Orillia Area Physician Recruitment and Retention Committee, Dr. Matt Miller. I'm sorry, I got the right closet here. Thanks. Okay, so the, apologize, first report's Corporate Services Report, Redraft 2023 Budget. File F5-23. John. So John Henry.
Great. Thank you, Mayor McIsaac and members of council. The team is very glad to be at this stage of the budget process and present the draft 2023 budget. Overall, staff feel this is a very responsible budget given the current economic situation facing the community, and especially given the large external pressures faced by the provincial Bill 23 legislation and Simcoe County social service pressures. The budget before you is truly a collaborative effort, which includes the senior leadership team's direction, city division's input, involvement, and cooperation, and the finance team, which is a small group, but I would say the efforts to pull this together were tremendous this year. We recognize the Budget Committee and the public are very busy and may not have had time to review all the information provided. And to assist, we are providing a corporate overview to help everyone kind of ease into the budget conversation. No decisions are expected for today. That's important to note. However, they will be anticipated at the next scheduled meetings as we go through the information in more detail. So with that, let's get started. So next slide, please. So today's presentation will focus on the following topics. We'll touch on the budget process and timelines. We'll quickly review the documents that we've provided, provide an overview of the operating budgets, as well as get into the capital budget and the 10-year capital plan. As this presentation has lots of content, we humbly request that questions be maybe held to the end if that's possible. Next slide, please. So today's presentation goals are fourfold. We want to present the document framework, provide an overview of the budget, highlight key budget pressures, and obtain council input on priorities and, of course, budget direction. Next slide, please. The budget process is a pretty major event for the city, and this slide illustrates the roadmap of that journey. So it started with guidelines issued in the late summer, followed by divisions preparing and submitting their budgets in the fall. In November, the CAO and the General Manager of Corporate Services met with each division to review their budgets. In December, staff asked the new term of council about their priorities and direction, and in January, SLT then reviewed the budget and adjusted accordingly. We are now at the little red triangle there at the bottom, at the last stage, where we launch the budget to the community, and we begin to, the council vetting process. So fingers crossed, the 2023 budget is hopefully approved on February 27th. Next slide, please. Okay, Council recently saw this slide at the orientation session in December. As mentioned then, municipal budgets are very complex and involving many moving parts. This slide illustrates the building blocks for Orillia's budget. Starting with the operating budget, we will discuss the general levy. We'll move on to talk about service partners, ABCs, which are agencies, boards, and committees. That's an acronym that we use here. And then council priorities and referrals. Then moving to the rate-based budgets, which do not impact the overall levy, but will require review and approval, which include things like water, wastewater, storm, parking, and then we'll also touch on a couple of management boards, which we have, which are the Dougal Canal Management Board and the Orillia Downtown Management Board. Next slide, please. Listed here for your reference and convenience are the upcoming committee dates and topics. Please note, I think on this slide, the dates are correct on this slide, but the days of the week actually reflect the original schedule. So we apologize for that, but just note that down if you don't mind. Next slide, please. So before we get started, we should touch on the attachments provided. Firstly, it's organized in a binder for council for quick reference. A copy of the report and the presentation is also provided in front of that binder. Table of contents is also provided at the beginning of each attachment. So these are kind of new things this year for council. In addition, we have tabbed the council binder. So there are five big tabs for the main sections. For example, tab one is attachment two, which starts off with a bunch of corporate summaries. Tab two is the levy supported budget, followed by the rate budget, followed by the capital budget, and then of course the 10-year capital plan. And then the smaller numbered tabs reflect the budget change summaries. And I think that's important for council to know, as historically these documents are really what the budget committee has used to review and to adopt budget changes through motions. So within these sections, of course, are division summaries and business cases and capital project sheets. We also provided council priorities on pink sheets for quick, easy reference. In addition to this, there's information that are provided within separate reports, which are on today's agenda. Next slide, please. As mentioned, listed here, just for reference again, are just the tab change summaries to help council in the decision-making process. And these are the pages that we'll refer to as we move through next week's sessions. Next slide, please. Moving on to the city's general levy budget. Next slide. So this slide compares the 2022 to the 2023 levy. Overall, we're looking at a levy increase of about $1.7 million net of assessment growth, which is essentially additional taxation that comes online from new houses. Next, you see on this slide here, a 1% increase in the levy yields about $680,000 in new taxation. So as a result, the draft 2023 base levy increases about 2.5%, and including some of the council priorities, we're looking at roughly about a 2.94% total. It should be noted these figures are obviously draft and don't include some impacts that we need to go through, which are subject of content in the supplemental information reports that are provided on today's agenda. And another big topic would be the funding for requirements associated with the Bill 23 provincial legislation. The graph just below the table here compares the draft levy increases to prior years and approved increases. The current draft 2023 budget falls below both the pre-COVID and the seven-year historical average. And this is a very good news story for the community given the current economic climate. Next slide, please. So what does this mean on the average residential tax bill? So based on MPAC's average residential property value, a 2.94% increase would equate to about $112 extra per year, or approximately $37 for every $100,000 in assessed property value. So the average assessed property value that's currently being used is about $300,000, which is really a blend of all residential types, which would include things like condos, apartments, townhouses, detached houses. And I should also note that it's also based on the province's 2016 assessment values. They haven't been able to perform a reassessment for some time now. So MPAC, the Municipal Property Assessment Corporation, is currently reassessing those values and probably looking to implement them in 2024. But I just want to mention again, and it's important to clarify, that when reassessment does occur, that the city doesn't really benefit from this activity, as we will adjust our rates down to achieve the same levy value for the city. And so the average property shouldn't really see any change in taxation, unless, of course, their property value assessment is higher or lower than the average. So I just want to make that point there. So next slide, please. So in discussing preliminary levy increases with surrounding area treasurers, Orillia compares actually very, very well. Listed on the screen are 10 municipalities in the various stages of their draft budgets. It should be noted that all of these rates are draft and, of course, subject to change. For example, I just recently heard this week that Collingwood approved a 2.7%, Midland approved a 4.58%, and Severn approved a 5.51%, which isn't noted on the screen because this information came after the fact. Of note, however, is that Orillia is the green bar and it is one of the lowest listed on this chart. And with exception for Barrie, the others are lower tier municipalities, and what will happen is they will blend their rates with the Simcoe of County. And even with that blending, the comparative increase will be similar or above where Orillia is currently in the draft stage. So this slide here, I think, really demonstrates Orillia's fiscal constraint and commitment to providing value for the taxpayer's dollar. Next slide, please. So this is an important slide, which I believe Council's seen before, and it illustrates financial pressures faced by most Canadians right now. The city is particularly sensitive to the CPI line, which is the blue line, specifically for contracts. Unemployment, which is the yellow dotted line, is an indication of emerging labor force challenges. And on the capital side, the construction index, or the orange line, has drastically risen. And then the bank prime rate, which is the gray line here, is also trending up, which places pressure, obviously, on capital financing costs. It should be noted that the draft 2023 budget levy increase is substantially below all of these figures, and Orillia is more than holding the line on inflation. Next slide, please. This slide is provided to illustrate the revenue streams within Orillia's levy budget. As illustrated, 78% is funded from property taxation, which is our largest source. Only 14% is supported by fees and charges. The balance, about 8%, consists of a variety of items such as reserve funding, investments, grants, recoveries, things of that nature. It should be noted that these figures do exclude the rate-based budget, such as water, wastewater, parking, and things of that nature. Next slide, please. This slide quickly illustrates where Orillia's tax dollars go. Municipal taxes provide significant value to residents, and too often we are focused on just a very specific service at hand. But municipalities are very, very complex, and the budget supports hundreds of services. And it helps to kind of pause for a minute and reflect on what is offered for the average tax bill, which is just under $4,000. And just to take a moment here, that balance would include services such as 24/7 emergency services for police, fire, and ambulance, long-term care and social housing, growth planning and engineering, roads and sidewalks, street lighting, snow plows, solid waste pickup, recreation facilities, park and playgrounds, trails and beaches, culture and heritage services, library services, and a host of other services. So the chart that's on this slide currently illustrates that 26% of this budget is related to capital investment, which supports about $600 million in infrastructure. 23% of the budget supports police and fire services, 11% supports county-based social services like affordable housing, long-term care and paramedics, and the remaining 40% supports the various other community services that we just mentioned. Next slide, please. So now we'll move on to some budget pressures, just to make note of those. Next slide, please. So breaking down the budget, this slide helps to illustrate the city's base budget pressures. So from a core budget perspective, the city is looking at a 1.37% levy increase, which consists of the following items. Firstly, labor accounts for about a third of all city's expenses, and as a result, there's a natural pressure to support labor agreements and statutory payments and things of that nature. For example, CPP, EI, EHT are planned to increase at over 5% for 2023. In addition, there is a need to adjust the fire overtime budget to reflect historical trends. Overall labor costs increased just under 3%, which equal about a 1.29% levy increase. Second on this list are contracts, which also account for about a third of the overall city's budget. Overall, this category increased about 9.7% and is very sensitive to inflationary pressures, which generated about a levy increase of about 1.19%. The other base adjustments here are related to kind of one-time removals and revenue adjustments for fees and charges and things of that nature, which resulted in a budget reduction offsetting the above pressure. The next section here speaks to service partners. And so the city works with service partners such as OPP for policing and Simcoe County for social services, which benefit, you know, the city through economies of scale. These services account for about 20% of the city's expenses. And there's going to be more on this topic in the next slides. And then lastly, of course, there's assessment growth. And then so this tax revenue we receive as a result of new houses being built, and which is needed to fund the general pressures on services and infrastructure. So taking this into consideration with these items, the city would be looking at a 1.37% levy increase overall. Next slide, please. So this chart here focuses on the contract line budget, which totals about $28.8 million, about one-third of the city's levy-based expenses. About 60% of this figure relates to service-based contracts for policing and social services, and the balance, about 10.9%, is highlighted here. So as we can see, there are some sizable increases, which are both based on inflationary adjustments and obviously volume adjustments. And these relate to things like property maintenance, transit, pavement marking, solid waste contracts, IT licenses, etc. I should also mention that these are raw contract account increases, and some of these would actually have some revenue offsets. Next slide, please. This slide here looks at our service partner budget changes. The policing contract here increased by about $105,000, which is about 1.2% overall on the line. Not shown here, but within the police board budget, there were some grants that were secured, which will more than offset this pressure, so that's pretty good news. County services, though, has a very different outcome than what we just talked about here on the police services budget. And as illustrated, the county provides a variety of services, with the largest being social housing, long-term care, and paramedic services. The total contract increase here is about $930,000, or 11%. And 90% of this increase is really due to major facility capital payments. So these projects here, if you want more detail, are listed on page 52 of your agenda, just as a note. And the large changes are really related to Simcoe Manor and then Orillia Affordable Housing, which is coming on stream very soon, and interest on all projects that are moving forward. It should be noted that the major capital facility payment pressure is planned to continue at the rate of about $500,000 annually for the next 3 years. There is also pressure related to offsetting revenue transfers. So most importantly are the impacts of Bill 23, which we've heard a lot about lately. Bill 23 actually eliminated the city's ability to collect, social housing DCs. And in 2022, we had actually budgeted $460,000 as allocated to minimize the impacts associated with that program. In 2023, we'd planned for $670,000, which is currently now zero. Staff increased the stabilization reserve funding to help smooth this impact a little bit. I should note that earlier this week, we did receive a very positive update from the county, and they indicated that their overall budget figure would be reduced by about $300,000. So that helps. It doesn't get it to where we need it to be, but it does obviously help. And this is largely due to some operational savings that they've got in their labor component and a reduction in the Simcoe Manor project, which was quite high. The revised budget will adjust this change to about $782,000 net impact. And this is equivalent to about a 1.15% levy change. So we should also note here that just briefly that the city also supports the Simcoe County Health Unit, and that budget is about $490,000, which includes an estimated 4% increase. Their board is looking to finalize their budget later this month, and we may receive an update from them during our process. Next slide, please. So this slide here reflects assessment growth, which is the volume increase of new property development. The figure assists in managing general growth pressures the city is facing. And these figures were provided by MPAC in December, and they're relatively firm. So normally this number doesn't come forward. Normally we're well underway of our budget process. Before we receive this number, we have to make some estimates, but it's good to be able to say right now that that number is firm and it won't change. So as illustrated, assessment growth is consistent and slightly above the historical five-year average. Next slide, please. This slide here illustrates the service enhancement request portion of the budget. The city categorizes requests into three main groups. Category three, which is ongoing, totaling about $550,000, of which $260,000 relates to the staffing that's listed here on the slide. Some of these positions, I will note, are split between rate-based budgets and the levy budget, and a more detailed list of these positions is provided on page 25 of attachment two. Category four is related to one-time enhancements totaling $255,000. These requests will be removed from future budgets. And some of the larger items here are also listed on the slide, representing about 70% of this balance. Category five is really related to capital project operating implications. And so there are about 12 capital projects with operating costs, three of which make up about 85% of this value. And these items are also summarized on page 27 of attachment two. When adding these enhancements to the core base budget, the net levy change is about 2.74%. Next slide, please. The next section here focuses in on agencies, boards, and committees, and we typically term those ABCs around here, so you'll hear that acronym thrown around. The Police Services Board, excluding the policing contract, which we just previously discussed, has generated a net savings, largely due to new grants for the prisoner transportation and commuting, community policing grants. A summary of this is on page 107 of on attachment 2. Really, a public library is largely subsidized through taxation. The 2023 budget request is for about $2.6 million, which is a 12% increase overall. A summary is on page 111 of attachment 2, and changes are detailed on page 23. The balance of these items here are related to committees and community donations. The total budget for these items is about $348,000, which is an overall reduction from 2022 of about $63,000. Summary is provided on page 31 of attachment 2 if you're looking for that information. I should just note that the reductions here illustrated relate to the removal of one-time funding for Building Hope and Orillia Hospice. There was also an adjustment for Mariposa based off of an updated memorandum of understanding. And I believe the WEMAC budget transfer to operations was to help with community education, and that offsetting this was an increase in the physician recruitment and information Orillia. So when we add these ABCs to the budget, the levy change then falls to 2.5%. Next slide, please. So this section here references items staff felt council may wish to discuss considering the recent 2022 to 2026 council term priorities. These items total about $300,000 with about a 0.44% levy impact and relate to the following: a housing coordinator, an equity, diversity, and inclusiveness coordinator, implementing senior transit fares potentially, and a climate action plan coordinator, which is funded through both the levy and the rate-based budgets. There are also some minor operating implications associated with capital priorities, such as I think there's a cold water road pedestrian crossing that's been added, valued about $35,000 with a small minor $1,000 operating implication. And then there's a bigger project for the council chamber upgrades valued at $570,000 with about a $5,000 operating implication. So adding these items would result in an overall levy increase of about 2.94%. In your package, these requests are printed on pink sheets, so you can identify them very quickly. And there is one other item which does require some attention, and so I'll mention that now. Recently, the province implemented Bill 23, which essentially migrates away from the philosophy of paying for growth. And so last week, we heard from Hempson Consulting on the topic when he put forward some information on development charges, who indicated that this change could cost taxpayers about $12 million over the next 5 years, potentially doubling over 10 years. As a result, it might be worth consideration or discussion whether we should be looking at maybe applying some budget funding in anticipation for this event. And so staff are kind of recommending that maybe we put in a placeholder of about $1 million, which would be split between the levy and the rate-based budgets. And this would be a good start as demonstrated, which will be demonstrated on the next slide. And staff can then monitor this activity, and we can maybe report back later in the year on maybe how this further unfolds. Overall, this would increase the overall tax levy by about 0.88%, which would increase the levy to 3.83. So taking into consideration the recent change in the levy from the county's reduction, we might be looking at maybe a 3.39% overall is what we'd be looking at. Next slide, please. So continuing with the conversation on Bill 23, this slide indicates the range of the 2023 financial implications associated with that piece of legislation. So as we already know, there are impacts with Bill 23 related to ineligible classification of social services and studies, which is indicated at the top of the slide. But there are much larger consequences related to these new DC discounts and exemptions. And this table compares what we know on these exemptions and compares it to historical and forecasted development trends. As a result, in 2023, there will be a requirement for existing taxpayers to subsidize DCs by about 25% to 30%. And depending on the development performance, this is likely the range of that value is about $1 million to $3 million, hence why we're recommending the $1 million threshold at this point in 2023. And another risk that we should be considering here is timing. And what I mean by this is if the city continues to build infrastructure based on provincial targets, but if the development does not materialize, then it's important to recognize that the city will need to cash flow those projects from other sources. And so moving forward, I think we need to be very, very careful in monitoring the DC balances and adjusting accordingly if needed. Next slide, please. So rate-based operating budgets, we'll move on to that section. Next slide, please. So this slide here quickly glances at rate-based budgets, and as demonstrated, water and wastewater revenues are increasing at about 2%, with expenses increasing around 11%, which reduces the overall contributions to reserves. A report on these rates is provided on today's agenda. I believe option two is included within the budget, while option one is really what staff is recommending. The 10-year capital plan reflects the 2022 contributions currently until a decision on rates is really determined. These reserves are forecasted to be in a positive position, with water declining but still in a positive position, while wastewater increases. And based on the contributions in the chart, the water reserve would fall into a negative position in 2028. The stormwater program listed here, the third item down, is emerging with a new revenue structure and a focus on requirements. Substantial revenue increases are needed to fund future capital requirements and rising operational costs. So this adjustment is really needed to maintain the stormwater reserve in a positive position and keep it stable over the next 10 years. Parking revenues mildly increase with a sharp increase in expenses. As a result, the net reserve transfer transitions to a mild subsidy. A report on parking is anticipated later in the year, and holding the contribution to 2022 levels would result in an increasing reserve balance, while basing it on the above plan would result in a relatively flat reserve over the next 10 years. So that seems to work out okay. Rate-supported budgets and the change summaries begin on page 120 of Attachment 2, and reserve forecasts are included in Attachment 3. Next slide, please. Okay, so this slide illustrates rate-based service enhancements broken down by category. As illustrated, the largest component relates to the first line, which are the ongoing enhancements. More than half of this budget for water, wastewater enhancements relates to shared staffing requests. And these are kind of illustrated in the middle of the slide here. Stormwater enhancement is really related to the revenue adjustments previously mentioned and detailed in the supplemental report. And then the next line, which are the one-time costs, are related to things like facility equipment maintenance, waterfront parking shuttle for during some construction that's going to occur. And then the last line, which is the capital rate implication, is really based on anticipated revenue associated with, I guess, the boat trailer parking project. In addition to those items, there are a few council priority decisions listed at the bottom of the slide, and these items were previously illustrated in the levy section, but this portion is really the rate-based allocation, and more detail is provided on page 180 of Attachment 2. Lastly, there are two reports on today's agenda related to the above services. Next slide, please. All right, so moving on to the capital budget. This slide here provides a brief overview of the capital budget. Overall, we're looking at 72 projects requesting a total of about $30.8 million. The majority, the blue slice, at 68%, resides with development services and engineering, and about 30%, the next slice, is managed with environmental and infrastructure services. The balance of 2% is spread across all the other city services. The 2023 capital budget is funded within available sources, with the exception for development charges, which is a recovering negative balance. Some debt financing is required for larger projects, but within the city's policy parameters. Next slide, please. This slide here demonstrates the funding sources for the capital budget. As illustrated, 46%, or roughly half of the program, is funded by city reserves, which is the blue slice, and it's really geared towards asset replacement. 30% is planned to be debt funded, which is the orange slice, and that's primarily to support the Lackley Street and Centennial Drive projects. And then 9% is development charge funded, which is the gray slice, which supports capital projects. I should note that about 4.5% of the debt slice is actually related to debt projects. And then the next slice, which is related to grants, is 11%, and that's primarily associated with funding through the Ontario Community Infrastructure Funding Source and federal gas tax. 4% is funded by the capital tax levy, and I should just mention that 20% of the annual transfer to this reserve is earmarked for council's discretion. Next slide, please. This slide here focuses on the top valued projects within the capital budget. Noteworthy is that 75% of the 2023 capital investment resides within 10 projects. The top three projects make up 40% of the budget and relate to Lackley Street, which is phase one of a $30 million multi-year capital project. There's also the wastewater aeration project, and then Centennial Drive area improvements. This particular portion of the budget is the first part of the final phase of a $33 million multi-year project. The next seven projects total $10 million and are listed here. And I should just note that the transit and the fleet projects are annual capital programs. Next slide, please. Similar to operating, this section here references options that staff felt that council may wish to consider as part of their term of council priorities. More detail is available starting on page 275 of attachment 2. The majority of these items are accommodated within general reserves and a small portion from DCs. A number of these projects are funded within CTL, which is the short term for capital tax levy. Traditionally, 20% of that transfer is earmarked for use by council, and of the $411,000 allocation, there is a residual balance of $146,000. About 50% of these requests really reside within two major projects, the first one being the council chamber upgrades at $570,000, and then the next one would be the J.B. Tud Hope Memorial Park improvements at $200,000. Next slide, please. Moving on to the 10-year capital plan. So this chart here illustrates the city's forecasted capital investment trends. The green dotted line represents the city's five-year historical average investment. The blue line is the forecasted capital investment valued at about $411 million, which is a little bit up from last year's $387 million. The trend continues to be a little skewed towards the earlier years, which is really not that uncommon as divisions are focused on more immediate needs. But what is really apparent is the large wave of capital projects in the next 3 years. And this is really related to a number of very, very large projects, such as an operational center, transit terminal and parking structure, Lackley Street, Fitton's Road pump station, waste diversion capping, a fire engine, and a few others. The use of debt is leveraged to smooth out these costs and reduce this pressure, which actually kind of straightens out that line a little bit more for us. Next slide, please. This chart here illustrates the 10-year capital spend by area and capital funding sources. The trends are really proportionate and consistent with what we illustrated in the 2023 capital budget, so I won't spend a lot of time on here. It's just at a larger scale. Next slide, please. This slide here is focused on the top valued projects within the 10-year capital plan. Noteworthy are the top five lines. In the next 10 years, about $152 million will be invested in road-related programs. So pretty big program. That's about 37% of the forecast and an average of about $15 million per year. The other 11 programs on this list make up about 32%, the largest being the transit terminal and parking structure, planned to start in 2024 at a value of $39 million. The remaining 31% consists of 311 projects, which also include about $5.8 million allocated to various climate action plan items. Next slide, please. So this slide here illustrates the trend in the city's capital financing forecast. The city currently leverages debt for two projects. One is the street lighting LED program, and the next one is Centennial Drive, which was issued in 2022. Library debt, I should just comment, recently matured at the end of 2022, which is what's causing that slight dip in the chart in the 2023 line. This graph, I should comment, is based on the city's ratio of annual debt service payments to own source revenues. And this is a metric that is used by the province typically to monitor, but also to limit the amount of municipal debt. The provincial maximum threshold is 25%, but through policy, council has limited debt to 10% to be conservative and is consistent with municipal association best practice. Illustrated to the right of the slide here are the number of large projects that are earmarked for debt financing. And these projects are really what's creating that wave that we saw on the previous slide. And as a result, that financing is used to kind of smooth these costs out over time. And as demonstrated here, the city's ARL climbs steadily, peaking at about 7.9%, but then it obviously tapers off to about 6% mark, which is well within the city's current policy. There is some rate-related risk, but staff have kind of built this into the forecast, so I think we're comfortable there. Next slide, please. So this slide here provides an overview of the reserve category forecasts. Supporting each category is a group of similar reserves. The details provided on page 3 of attachment 3 if you're interested. Overall reserves are mostly positive and increasing, with exception for the following. The corporate category falls negative in 2028, and this is largely due to the transit terminal and parking structure project. As this project is a new initiative, the funding source selected here is the capital levy reserve. The pressure is a result of the annual debt payments of $2.3 million exceeding what the annual reserve transfer would be, plus there's also competition from other projects for this source of funding. A future report is planned for this project later on this year for further conversation. The next area that's obviously into a negative position is a development charge category. Collectively, this is in a negative position, and this is really stemming from the pre-building of infrastructure in advance of growth. Most individual DC reserves are in this position. You know, with the largest related to recreation, wastewater, and fire. As illustrated, this category position is forecasted to collectively improve, but again, this outcome is highly dependent on three particular items. One is that the development community meets the provincial targets when they're building. Number two is largely due, to the city's ability to fund Bill 23 discounts and exemptions. And the third piece is the city's ability to manage projects within the collections. So if all those things happen as planned, we should probably be in the positive. If not, we will fall further into a negative position. There is one other reserve of note in the asset management category, which you can't see here because we're looking at this collectively, but it's the water asset management reserve, which temporarily dips into a negative position in 2028. And this is largely due to some big street improvements on Harvey Street, Jarvis, and Lackley Street. But it does recover in 2029 based off of the forecast. That said, we should say that this reserve does slowly decline from about $12 million to about $2 million over the 10-year period. And, forecasting contributions are based off of historical levels. Other than those mentioned, I think all the other reserves are anticipated to be in a positive position and improving, which is a good sign. It's something that the city has been focused on for some time now, and I think we're starting to see some of those benefits. Next slide, please. So running down to the summary here, just to give you a quick recap. Next slide, please. So in summary are the key takeaways. So the draft tax levy increases about 2.94%, including council priorities. With the county update, this figure is closer to 2.5%. So I think that's a pretty positive note. Major pressures driving this increase relate to county-provided services, standard labor adjustments, and, of course, contract inflation. The provincial Bill 23 is a big financial pressure on the city, which could add an additional 0.88%. To the levy and on other rates as well. Rate-based budgets overall require some guidance on fees and are the subject of a number of reports that are sitting on today's agenda. The biggest pressure relates to stormwater rates, which are really needed to support the capital program. The capital program in general is about $30.8 million, and the program is fully funded, leveraging some debt for larger projects. Reserves overall are in a positive position, with exception for negative DC balances, which are scheduled to improve. The 10-year capital plan is valued at $411 million and shaping up quite nicely. Reserves are improving, and some debt is required on the larger projects, but it stays within policy. There are also some minor negative reserve positions that require some refinement, and the transit terminal and parking structure is a big project, creating some reserve pressure that will require some further discussion later on within the year. And as mentioned with the capital project, a big concern is Bill 23 and how municipal funding of those DCs will unfold. Staff plan to perform some more in-depth study on this, and once the regulations are released, we plan to come back with a really refined strategy. And so with that is the end of our presentation. Thank you for paying attention. It was quite long, and we are open for questions.
Thank you, John. That's well done, and certainly not gone unnoticed, a significant amount of input staff put into preparing all this stuff. So well done, team.
Thank you.
Do we open for questions now? Jay, looks like you're a little anxious. Imagine that.
I'll start the ball rolling. Just some quick questions. Looking at in the final summary point slide, there's reference to 2.94% tax levy increase, but I know on another slide we were looking at 3.8 with reference to Bill 23 pressures that we're anticipating. First question is which one are we actually looking at, I guess? And then the second question was sometimes we can expect offsets through the education. There's always an education fund that can sometimes offset that, or rebates from the province, I believe. Is there any chance that could come into play this year? Thanks.
Through the mayor to Councillor Fallis. So a couple questions there. So the first one is, I think what we tried to do is stagger the budget levy increase into three major sections. And so we weren't quite sure where council wanted to land. So we kind of said, here's the base levy increase, which is that lower number that you're seeing. And they were saying there's a number of council priorities that, you know, kind of popped up during December. We recognize it's a new term of council, so we're not exactly sure if that was, you know, if we're meeting those expectations. So we wanted to group those separately. And then the last piece here is about really Bill 23 and whether council wants to go down that path at the early stages or wait to see some of those impacts first before addressing it. So really what we're trying to do is build that overall levy increase into those sections. So if you look at the council report that's created, you'll see at the bottom of that report, you'll see all those numbers kind of building up to that final levy increase. So really, I think what we're looking for is council's direction on where they want to go. Do they just want to stay with the base budget? They want to go base plus priorities, or do they want to go base plus priorities plus Bill 23 funding? And regarding the last question that you had, I'm not actually clear on the rebate that you're referring to. I don't know if you're referring to the school board tax rate, but that's a very small portion. It's not really within the city's control.
All right. Okay.
So I think what you're referring to is the blended rate with the school board taxes. Yeah, so we did illustrate that in the slide 11, so it does show what that is. I don't think we're anticipating any increase in the school board tax rate, but I'll be honest, it's quite small, so it doesn't really have a significant impact on our overall rate. In the case of other municipalities that are lower tier, and they're having, say, an increase of the 5-6% range, they blend with the county, which is at a 3.5. So they will see a noticeable difference, but we're not in that same situation because we're a single tier municipality.
Okay, great, thanks. Anybody? Mr. Lauer.
Thank you, Mayor McIsaac. We're anticipating the impacts from Bill 23, and we're looking to mitigate them by this contribution. Is that an admission that we do not believe the minister when he says they will make us whole?
through the mayor to the councillor, I don't know if it's an admission. I think it's more about trying to be proactive.
I think it's conservative.
If anything.
You can't count on it, really.
But they have said that. He did make that statement that they would make us whole, I believe.
Not that a politician would ever mislead anybody.
No. Perish the thought.
Through the chair, all I can comment on is that we did hear from Hempson Consulting a few weeks ago, and I think he was asked the same question. He said at this point in time he has not received any information from the province on how that funding will work or if there will even be any.
We still haven't even got the guidelines, from what I understand, John, with the details, so it's hard to...
That's correct. The regulations have not been issued.
But I think it's a good assumption to leave it out.
Yeah, I don't know. I appreciate the conservative nature of it for sure. I'm just wondering if we had heard any definitive word there that would indicate that it's not going to happen. I have a second question, though, sort of along the same lines. So I think, and I apologize, I can't pull out the exact location, but I did see the operating budget subsidized somewhat by the tax stabilization. Is that right? What is the total of that subsidy?
Are you referring to the county services?
No. I thought I read in here a part where we were offsetting one of our operational costs through the tax stabilization.
I believe you're referring to the county services, where we currently had a contribution going into reserves, and we were pulling money out of reserves to offset the county services. And so I believe that number now is about $900,000 and change. I think that's what you're referring to.
I actually thought I saw it coming from the tax stabilization, but it's okay. I can find that out later and ask. But anyway, my only concern there would simply be some of the other issues we've gotten into in the past, where the 1 year we took money out of the tax stabilization to support the operating, which made us all look wonderful, but a year later we had to make it up. So I'm just wondering if there's any component that we're going to have to make up in the following years.
Through the chair, I believe the one that you're referring to is the county services, and I don't have a problem meeting with you maybe after the meeting to go through that information with you. Right now, I think we have a levy contribution of about $900,000, so we weren't using that full contribution. What's happening right now is we're applying that full contribution to that operating budget. So from a sustainability perspective, that's fine. I think when we get into next year's budget or future budgets, there may be an issue where we need to supplement it with further reserve funding, and that may not be sustainable. But I think that's maybe what you're referring to. Okay, is the risk about, you know, maybe applying finite, you know, numbers to a permanent ongoing cost. And so you're right about that. It would be prudent to make sure that we're...
Okay, but it's not an issue this year.
Yeah, it's not an issue this year currently.
Thank you, Tim. Ralph?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and through you. Excellent job on the presentation. Thank you very much. Jay's question, the education tax. So you don't feel there's going to be a major increase in the education tax, even with the union's request for higher wages and everything else that's coming?
Through the chair to Councillor Cipolla, at this stage, we have not heard anything from the province of increasing that rate. So I think what I'm hearing right now from staff is because of the assessment change, they're not looking to make that adjustment in 2023. Doesn't mean that next year for 2024, that there might be a larger increase. Unfortunately, my crystal ball is broken, so I can't tell you what that might be.
Okay, if I may, Mr. Mayor, I have one more. You have long-term care at 27% increase. Is that designated by the province, or because the province is, my understanding, is putting a lot of money into the facilities that they're doing, why is that increase at 27% from us?
Why?
Mm-hmm.
My understanding is it's a variable rate based on the activity.
But if the province is subsidizing a lot of this, why is it included in ours?
I'll have to take a note, Ralph. I'm not precisely sure that is followed through on the budget with the inputs.
Okay, if I may, Mr. Mayor, my last question then is COVID-19 is not over. So what happens to our budget or our funds if COVID-19 resurrects itself and we have to declare emergencies? And they're asking for testing the wastewater for COVID before it goes into the lakes or whatever. So I'm just concerned that maybe we should be putting some money aside for that emergency part of it. At least that's what I've been, the research that I've done through other agencies, that what I've been told, it might happen again.
Go ahead, John. There's a lot of things that might happen. You can't.
No, I realize that, but I think we have to be prepared, Mr. Mayor.
Sure. Well, let's be prepared is the motto, but I don't know that anyone's got any data that tells us that it's better than a 50, 60, 70% chance that COVID will resurrect itself and cause another problem. I mean, you know, hard to contemplate that. It's something we know that we haven't included in the budget, but I'm not sure anyone would raise their hand that we would include it. What do you think, John?
Through the chair to Councillor Cipolla, I think I just have maybe two comments. One is on your first comment, which is related to long-term care. I think that question might be well-suited for Monday morning's meeting. I think we have the county attending, and they probably will be able to answer that question in detail. And regarding your second question, we do have a tax rate stabilization reserve, and we're at the upper echelons of our policy for that number there. So I think worst-case scenario, if that was a circumstance that occurred, hopefully it doesn't. I think everyone is tired with COVID and wants to go away. But if it does, we could probably leverage those funds temporarily, and I'm sure there'll be probably additional, you know, provincial federal funding, which we could then claw back through that process. So I think at this stage, I think we would probably be we'd be well prepared.
Okay,
thank you.
Anybody, Jan Lynn?
Just circling back to Councillor Fallis's question. So on the summary slide, the final slide, the 2.94%, which is actually 2.5%, includes council priorities. Does that include mitigation of the Bill 23 impact? Or is it? Does that change that final figure?
Through the chair, I believe we were looking at, it's roughly about the reduction associated with the Simcoe County is about a 0.44% levy adjustment. So if you look at that final total, I think we're at 3.39, just reduce that by the 0.4. So we're roughly around 3.5 all in.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Janet. Any other questions? Number four for Dan.
Thanks, Mayor. Sorry, I could ask this afterwards, but just in the presentation of in the book itself, you take a section and you'll have labor this much, blah, 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 blah. And then there's administration. What is in administration? It's a separate line, and I just couldn't.
Through the chair, I believe you're referring to the summaries?
Yeah.
Yeah, so the way that we organized the summaries was we created account categories because we have so many, you know, accounts within our chart of account structure, and it would just be too long. We just grouped a number of administrative related accounts. So for each area, it could be related to a number of different things like printing or sundry expenses or whatever that might be.
Just basically office.
Most of it would be that. There could even be training and things like that in there. Right? Memberships would be another example.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you. No other questions? Christine, would you read the motion, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The motion is as follows, that this committee recommends to Council that report CS-2307, dated January 26, 2023, from the Corporate Services Department regarding an overview of the 2023 budget process be received as information.
Thank you, Christine. Any further discussion, David? Okay, moved by David, second by Whitney. Any further discussion then? All those in favor? Okay, motion is carried. Thank you, John. Okay, next up is Corporate Services Department regarding budgets and asset accounting, Ontario Regulation 284-09. Just got this one. Oh, okay.
Report on, apologies. Can you guys hear me? Good afternoon, Mayor and members of Council. Before you is a report on budgets and asset accounting, Ontario Regulation 284-09. The purpose of this report is to comply with the statutory requirement regarding accounting for capital assets and PSEP-related items. As most municipalities don't budget for amortization, future post-employee benefit expenses, or future solid waste landfill closure, this report is to disclose the position of the mentioned. The report is for information only. It's a housekeeping item to be received before an annual budget is passed.
Okay.
Happy to take any questions.
Christine, do you want to read the motion, then we'll
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. The motion is as follows, that this committee recommends to Council that report CS-2308, dated January 26, 2023, from the Corporate Services Department regarding budgets and asset accounting, Ontario Regulation 284-09 for the 2023 budget year be received as information.
Second by Jeff. Any discussion on this? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Thank you. Good job. Thank you. Okay, next up, Chief Administrative Office. Referrals to Budget Committee from the 2018 to 2022 term of Council, file F05-23.
Through you, Mayor McIsaac, this is just an information report. Attached to the report is an Excel spreadsheet that just identifies the outstanding referrals and how they have been addressed through the budget system. It is just to be received as information.
Okay, thank you. Could we have a motion?
Mr. Mayor, the motion is as follows, that this committee recommends to Council that report CAO 2304, dated January 20th, 2023, from the Chief Administrative Office regarding referrals to Budget Committee from the 2018-2022 term of Council be received.
Okay, thank you, Christine. Anyone want to move that? Moved by David, second by Janet. Any discussion on this? Councillor Fallis.
Thanks. Through the chair, just, I guess, a question on process. If we did have questions about elements of this, I assume it would be during the budget process we'd bring them up to confirm it.
Yeah, fair enough.
Thanks.
Any other questions? Okay, call a vote. All those in favor? Motion's carried. Okay, next up, item number four, the Corporate Services Department, Reuser Fees, Recreation and Youth Services Division, file F05-23.
Through you, Mayor McIsaac, the purpose of this report is to identify that the Recreation and Youth Services division revenue of approximately $4 million, inclusive of parks, recreation, facility rentals, and programs, reflected in the draft budget documents, includes a placeholder amount of approximately $300,000 proposed to be derived through an increase in user fees. Council will receive additional details on February 13, 2023, through a detailed report. Based on the current rate schedule timeline, the new rates will become effective on May 1st, 2023.
Right. Thank you for that. Christine, could you read the motion, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report CS-23060 to January 18th, 2023 from the Corporate Services Department regarding an overview of user fees for the Recreation and Youth Services Division be received.
Okay. Thank you for that. If I could have a mover and seconder, moved by David, seconded by Luke. Any discussion on this? All those in favor? Motion is carried. Next, item number five, Business Development, Culture and Tourism Department, Re-Equity, Diversity and Inclusion Options, file F05-23.
McIsaac, sorry about that. The report in front of you will be for Council to evaluate options to have an internal focus on advancing equity, diversity, inclusion. That'll be brought forth during the budget process as well.
Okay, great. Thank you, Michael. Could you read the motion?
Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report BDCT 2301, dated January 22nd, 2023, from the Business Development, Culture, and Tourism Department regarding options to advance equity, diversity, and inclusion within the City of Orillia be received.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I have a mover and seconder? Moved by David, seconded by Ralph. And then any discussion on this motion at this point? No discussion, I'll call a vote. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Thank you. Item number six, the Development Services and Engineering Department, re-shade structure at Orillia Kiwanis Skateboard Park, file F05-23. Who's got that one?
Through you, Mr. Chair. Yeah. Through you, Mr. Chair. The purpose of this report is to respond to a council referral to install a shade structure at the Kiwanis Skateboard Park in Veterans Memorial Park. $25,000 is requested for this undertaking, and any unused funds would be returned to the appropriate reserve. Installing a shade cell at the Kiwanis Skateboard Park would extend the lifespan of this feature and provide shade to the users. Is there any questions? I'd be happy to answer them.
Well, good. Thank you for that. Christine?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report DSC 2306, dated January 24th, 2023, from the Development Services and Engineering Department regarding the shade structure at Orillia Kiwanis Skateboard Park be received.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I have a mover and seconder? Moved by Jeff, seconded by Ralph. Any discussion on this motion? Jay.
Thanks. Through the chair, I just had a question to John, and I was just kind of... it's just a preliminary question, but I was curious around the structure itself. There's been $25,000 designated, and I know one of the things that's being considered is a new skate park at the rec center. Just reading over the report, it sounds like we'd be waiting on a grant opportunity, I guess. Is there kind of the one question that came to mind was, as opposed to spending $25,000 on the shade structure, could we look at something that's less significant, like $5,000 on the shade structure, which would still, I would think, cover a lot, and then divert the $20,000 to, you know, future uses as it pertains to the skate park at the rec center. Was that a consideration? Are there any kind of less expensive options in terms of the $25,000 structure? Thanks.
John?
Yeah, so this project is being pursued completely independent of the Foundry Park concept plan that's being developed. That's without funding, and it's not known the timeline with which it'll take to install that. The approximate $25,000 is for a 25 by 25 shade sail. It would be pole mounted. There are lesser expensive ways of providing shade. It's either a smaller shade structure or a different type of structure. They have portable umbrellas. We have them installed at Tuthoe Beach, at Moose Beach. if Council chose to skinny that amount down to somewhere closer to 15,000, there would be smaller versions of shade we'd be able to install, much less than that, and it starts to, we wouldn't be purchasing a proper manufactured insured and warranted shade sale. Alternatively, we plant trees and we wait for a while for them to grow.
Okay, that's a good point, but it's a good point too, Jay, if there's another alternative out there, I might look at that during deliberations. Could we read the motion, then we'll put in, sorry, it hasn't read, okay, then we've got seconder and ready to go, so let's vote. Any further discussion, first of all? Anybody? Okay, let's vote. All those in favor? Okay, motion's carried. Okay, item number 7. Development Services in Engineering and Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, read 2023 to 2026, Water and Watershed Rates and Fees, file 05-23.
Through you, Mr. Mayor. Yep. The report on the wastewater and wastewater rates and fees. Sorry, I'm getting feedback. Is it coming through okay?
You're fine.
Okay. The report on the water and wastewater rates and fees for 2023 to 2026 is intended to present the rate and fee changes required to accommodate the capital projects and operating expense of the water and wastewater infrastructure over that span of time. Option 1 is the recommended approach, which is projected to provide rate increases at a sustainable rate over 4 years with no net negative impact on the water or wastewater reserve. Option 2, which was carried in the operating budget projections as a low increase option, reflects the recommendations of the drinking water financial plan completed in 2020. This is not recommended as the projected revenues under this approach are projected to have a severe negative impact on the water reserve and a minimal impact on the wastewater reserve. At this point, I'd be happy to address any questions.
Okay, thank you, Stephen. Good job. Do you want to read the motion, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report DSC 2304, dated January 18th, 2023, from the Development Services in Engineering and Environment and Infrastructure Services Departments regarding an overview of water and wastewater rates and fees be received.
Thank you, Christine. Can someone move and second? Moved by Jeff, second by Janet. Discussion? Councilor Wallace.
Thanks. Through the chair, I just had a couple quick questions for Stephen. One was, and I recognize the percentage, it says 6%, and then there's kind of a mention of it being an estimated average increased cost of $56 outlined. I was curious, just kind of thinking about kind of inflation and why it's as high as 6% and why it's been consistently at 6%. Just curious if there's any kind of leeway there. I don't know if you can weigh in on that. Thanks.
Through the chair, certainly there's leeway in that we can borrow from the reserve and go up by a lower percentage. These rates were developed in order to accommodate for the next 4 years of capital projects and projected operating expenses based on the amount of expected consumption. So in terms of it rising by 6% year over year, I would speculate that the rates were probably not sufficient early on, and we've been making up for that. We also have a very aged infrastructure system. Our water system went in 1914, so there are still some pipes that are from that era. So as we run into these older infrastructure issues, then we do have to make up for that money to be able to replace that infrastructure. And also, I would capital inflation, construction inflation certainly is going up faster than regular inflation, is my speculation. So I think John Henry showed that earlier on.
Okay. Thank you, Stephen. Anything else? Let's call the vote. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Next up, number 8. Development Service and Engineering and Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, read 2023 Stormwater Rates and Fees, file F05-23.
Is that okay? Report number DSE 2305, Stormwater Rates and Fees, is before the Budget Committee to recommend a one-year increase of the stormwater rate structure. The proposed base stormwater rate for residential property owners would increase from $59 per year to $102.20 per year. Relative rate increases have also been proposed for the other tiers of the stormwater rate structure. The rate increase has been proposed to address city's operations and capital needs that are currently identified within the city's 10-year plan. The rate increase has also been proposed to address the reduction of the financial contributions from alternate funding sources. The alternate funding sources were previously used to offset the impact of the stormwater fee to property owners. There will be insufficient funds for the current stormwater debt finance and proposed capital projects between 2024 and 2034 if the current stormwater rates are maintained. An increase in stormwater rates is required to maintain a positive stormwater reserve balance and to fund stormwater projects and operations beyond 2023. Further review of the stormwater rates will be required prior to 2024 and 2025 budget deliberations to ensure funding is available for additional stormwater capital projects, studies, and operations and maintenance of stormwater infrastructure. One source of additional capital projects will be from the ongoing Stormwater Master Plan update. Further capital projects will be proposed as per the recommendations of previous studies, and additional capital projects are anticipated from the currently proposed studies. I would be happy to answer any questions at this time.
Okay, great. Thank you. Christine, do you want to read the motion, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report DSC 2305, dated January 16, 2023, from the Development Services and Engineering and Environment and Infrastructure Services Departments regarding an overview of stormwater rates and fees be received.
Okay, thank you for that. Could I have a mover and second? Moved by Jay, second by David. Any discussion on this motion? Councillor Wallace.
Thanks. Back at it. Through the chair, just another question. Regarding option one and the increase to the stormwater rate from 59 to 102. And I'm just curious, like, it does represent nearly a doubling in this scenario. And I guess I'm just kind of curious, is, like, do we anticipate in the years to come that we'd be increasing this so much each year, or would this just be kind of a one-time increase of this rate? And then the next increases we anticipate being a lot lower.
Through you, Mayor McIsaac, to the councillor. At this time, we're looking at this as a one-year increase. Subsequent increases are likely. However, we are hesitant to predict what those increases will be until we have a clearer picture of what additional projects are going to be recommended through the ongoing studies and from some of the previous studies. So I'm cautioning that, yes, this is a large increase, but we are anticipating smaller increases that would assist in keeping up with the proposed projects.
Okay, thank you for that. One more.
Thanks. Just a quick comment, and I did want to say I do appreciate kind of, I know this is more of a newer program versus the wastewater and water, and recognize this is really important kind of on the environmental side of things in terms of ensuring the city's you know, doing all they can to mitigate the climate change issues. And so I did want to stress that as much as we're taking on the cost, it's for a good cause and it's for a good reason for sure. Thanks.
That's a good question. Okay, let's see, Mr. Lauer.
Just to add to Jay's question, the stormwater is no different than water, in the sense that water use, you can save money by conserving, and the same thing with storm water. If you take mitigating circumstances when you're constructing a parking lot or whatever you're doing, if you can find some way to keep that water on site or do mitigate, then you can save those costs. So it's not mandatory.
Okay. Good point. Any other questions? Okay, we have a motion on the floor. Can we call for a vote? All those in favor? Motion's carried. Next up, item number 9, Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, read 2023 Solid Waste Management Fees, file 05-23. Go ahead.
Thank you, Mayor McIsaac. The purpose of the report before you is to provide an assessment of current solid waste fees charged at the waste diversion site and to recommend changes to set fees. The focus of this report is uncovering the cost to operate and maintain that site. The proposed fee changes are meant to ensure that site users pay the cost of using the site, and it's also meant to help offset operating costs associated with tax impacts. Most of the proposed fee changes are related to chargeable items on site, so when you're dropping off at on site or if you're purchasing a new green bin or recycling box. I will point out that the garbage tag fee does apply at all tag sale locations, so City Hall and all of our other tag reseller locations. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, thank you, Greg. Can you read the motion, Christine, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report EIS BC 2302, dated January 20th, 2023, from the Environment and Infrastructure Services Department regarding an overview of solid waste management fees be received.
Thank you for that. Could I have someone move in second? Moved by David, second by Ralph. Okay, any discussion? Councillor Follis, who knew?
I felt I should kind of weigh in because I'm the council rep on the WEMAC committee, and there's two reports that have come forward. The one thing, and I'd invite Greg to weigh in after I kind of give my blurb here, was that I know kind of the Waste Management Committee was overall supportive of the rate increases. The areas I think there was some concern was with the one or two members were concerned with the dumping for compost and the increased price there. And then I know there were a couple of us as well around the tag cost increase. And we thought there might be alternatives in terms of, as opposed to going to the full $3, could we kind of meet in the middle or compromise in some way? So just wanted to pass on those comments, but I'll leave it to Greg to fill in any blanks. Kind of help her.
Go ahead, Greg. Any comments, Greg? Are you good?
Through you, Mr. Mayor, Councillor Follis has captured WEMAC's feedback very well. Thank you. I have nothing to add.
Okay, thank you. Okay, motion on the floor. Any other comments? Discussion? Okay, call the vote. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Item number 10, Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, re-garbage tag user pay program. File F05-23. Back to Greg.
Thank you, Mayor McIsaac. This report proposes moving to a full user pay program for garbage collection. It has been brought forward as a method to help minimize the property tax pressures and to further encourage waste diversion initiatives. One option is to implement a full user pay program in 2023 where no tags would be issued to households. A second option is to do this in a stage process where the tag allotment would be reduced in 2023 from the current allotment of 20 tags per household to 10 tags per household, and then moving to a full user pay program in 2024. A third option is no action. It is noted that the additional revenue noted within this report has not been included in the 2023 operating budget submission that John just went over. So that would be additional revenue over and above what's already been reported. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thanks for thanking me.
Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report EIS BC 2303, dated December 30th, 2022, from the Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, regarding an overview of a full user pay program for garbage collection, be received.
Thank you, Christine. Mover and seconder, moved by Whitney, second by Jeff. Any discussion?
Thanks. Through the chair, this should be my last comment, but I wanted to kind of speak as the WEMAC representative as well. The group as a whole recommended that the city not go down this route, that we pursue option three. There was one member of the committee that disagreed and suggested that we should be going for option one. on charging for all tags. One of the big comments I think that came out of this in terms of option three was that the group believed that there should be opportunities to try to reduce garbage as much as possible and encourage diversion. So one of the examples that was mentioned was trying to find opportunities to divert pet waste. And so the logic being the more that you could divert, the more kind of opportunity later on you could look at introducing a full charge system, whereas right now the group thought it would be better to wait, especially after the clear bag initiative was just laid out. Next.
Okay, thank you for that. Anybody else? All right. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Item number 11, Environment and Infrastructure Services Department, read Climate Change Action Plan, Implementation Update, File F05-23.
Mayor McIsaac and members of council, report EIS BC 23-04 serves to provide an annual progress and implementation update on the city's climate change action plan, also known as Orillia's Climate Future. Funding for priority actions and projects are proposed as part of the 2023 budget process and are summarized within the report for council's information. The report also includes a number of items, projects, progress achieved in recent years, and we wish to build on this momentum. Included in the operating budget, you'll see a request for a climate change action plan coordinator. This is an integral role to implement and maintain many of the projects and initiatives required to achieve our climate plan's goals corporately and within the community. 2023 capital budget requests include feasibility studies to electrify transit, further greenhouse gas facility audits, upgrades to city center's building automation system, additional water bottle filling stations, as well as some of the waste initiatives mentioned previously. And I'm happy to answer any questions on the report. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that, Christine. Read the motion, please.
That this committee recommends to council that report EIS BC 2304, dated January 18th, 2023, from the Environment and Infrastructure Services Department regarding an update on the implementation of the Climate Change Action Plan be received.
Thank you for that. Could I have a mover and seconder? Moved by David, second by Jeff. Any discussion on this motion? Councilor Lauer.
Thank you, sir. Through you to Tyler. So we have to have quite a bit done by the year 2030, right? 50%, I believe it is. And I'm thinking sort of along the lines of the 10-year capital forecast. Will we ever get sort of some sort of document or some sort of plan that's saying, okay, this is where we need to be in 2030, and give this council and subsequent councils the ability to look and say, okay, we're not moving enough, or we are moving fine, or we're comfortable with that. And so that at the end of any given year, you can feel good or bad about where you are. Will we get anything like that in the future?
So through the chair, Councilor Lauer, referring to the corporate plan. So the corporate plan for city facilities, city assets, is 50% reduction in GHGs by 2030. The community plan is 33%, so it's a bit somewhat less of that by then. We do have some targets for the longer term of how we would achieve those targets, but within that, short term and medium term implementation is really going to be left up to staff and in our work with stakeholders and within the city and yourselves to as to how we achieve that goal within that time period in the next 7 years.
Okay, so we've got the goal. We're just not sure how it's going to unfold.
We are, through the chair, we are working on an implementation plan that will cover the next 2 to 3 years, and we'll continue to build on that. Something mentioned in the report is really the value of those short-term wins to lay the foundation for building on those successes.
I'll take an example, the greenhouse gas facility audits. Until we really know the performance of our buildings and how we can reduce the energy and greenhouse gas of those buildings, we don't know the projects to pursue to then bring down those greenhouse gases.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Todd. Presumably you'll establish targets as you go, though. Establish targets as you go once you establish.
Yes, yeah, through you, Mr. Mayor. I expect in our implementation plan we'll have identify those short-term targets and show in real time our progress that we're making on those projects and how they're impacting our goals.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You allocated $35,000 for the redesign of the Brian Orser Arena the arena redesign. Can you just elaborate a little bit what that's going to be, what that's going to include?
So through the chair, Councillor Cipolla, that was allocated through last year's budget. So what we were able to do is, as that design was in progress, we were able to integrate energy efficiency opportunities into that design midway through, which isn't typical, but we were able to take advantage of that. So we're now working with that consultant to look at energy saving and greenhouse gas reduction opportunities with that redesign and that process, which is currently about 60%, and I believe it'll be moving forward in the coming weeks and months.
Thank you, Tyler. Good job.
Thank you.
All right. Motion in play. All those in favor? Motion is carried. Next up, item number 12, Environment and Infrastructure Services Department Reed Trail System, Dog Waste Bins, file
05-23. Thank you, Mr. Mayor. So on June 27th, Council passed a motion that a report be brought to Budget Committee that reviews the feasibility of implementing dog waste bins through the Orillia's trail system and identify opportunities for potential funding sources. Staff have provided an overview of the existing waste collection within parks and trails and have presented three options within the report, with staff's recommended option being to receive the report. Thank you, and I'd be happy to answer any questions Council may have.
Okay, thank you, Kyle. Could you read the motion, Christine, please?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, that this committee recommends to Council that report EIS BC 2301, dated November 24th, 2022, from the Environment and Infrastructure Services Department regarding dog waste bins through the Orillia Trail Systems be received.
Thank you for that. Could I have a mover and seconder? Moved by Jeff, second by Janet. Any discussion, questions, area of expertise, Jeff?
Two questions through the chair. One was, I wanted to confirm that we'll have a chance to discuss this more at budget. And number two was, I was curious if these options considered staff undertaking the removal, or was this through a private contractor that the dog waste would be removed? Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Councillor Fallis, the option to have separate dog waste bins was through a contractor, because the actual bins are sunk in the ground and require a crane to operate. And existing bins are collected internally, just for reference.
Okay, thank you, Kyle. All right, any other questions? All right, the motion's on the floor. All those in favor? Motion's carried. And then the budget package, Corporate Services Department, read 2023. The when? Oh, for Monday. So are we adjourning now? We have a motion to adjourn. Moved by Ralph, second by Luke. All those, any discussion, all those in favor? Okay, we're out of here. Thank you all.